first thing on the agenda is a public hearing for 40R plan review, 136 Haven Street. We're going to open that meeting, and then we have a note request for continuing, so. You want to do that?
Sure.
Notice is hereby given that under Mass General Law, Chapter 40A, Section 11, and Section 10.5.11.23 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, February 27th at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room of Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider an application for plan approval under Mass General Law 40R submitted by 136 Haven Street LLC for property located at 136 Haven Street and 0 Sanborn Street, Assessor's Map 16, Lot 380, and Assessor's Map 21, Lots 33 and 34. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Office in Town Hall, Monday through Thursday, 7:30 to 5:30, and Tuesdays, 7:30 to 7.
Thank you. So we have a request here from the applicant for to continue the public hearing to Monday, March 27th, 2017, and also granting a 45-day extension.
Move that the CBDC continue the public hearing for the application by 136 Haven Street LLC until Monday, March 27th at 7:30.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Okay. So the next thing on the
Nick, the A&R.
Yep. We have an A&R for that same parcel. Right here, so if we could do a motion to endorse that, we can all sign it. Looks like the town engineer has reviewed it and says that we can move forward with signing that.
Okay. Move that the CPDC endorse the approval not required plan for consolidating Assessor's Map 16, Lot 380, and Assessor's Map 21, Lots 33 and 34.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Okay. Let me start signing this.
For the public, the lots that we've mentioned here are the old post office and the lots on Sanborn Street right behind the post office. It was from the map point of view, there was three separate properties, and all that they're doing is extinguishing the lot lines between them to consolidate them into a single parcel.
Well, actually, just to add to David's comment, it does not include the parking lot. If anyone thinks that the parcels are, the parcel creeps back to that parking lot that's back there.
It doesn't include this one right here.
Does not include that, which is the parking lot.
Right, it does include this, this, and this.
Right. The old Reading Co-op parking lot is not part of this.
Thanks, Caitlin.
I Next item on the agenda is continued public hearing for definitive subdivision for 1260 and 1264 Main Street.
Can I use this one?
That's fine, yeah, sorry.
Do you want me to zoom in at all, or?
That's fine.
Okay.
Okay, my name is John Tillman for Lewis Myers Engineering. Joey, we were here a few weeks ago, actually about a month ago, this is continued public hearing. What I want to do tonight was just kind of let you know where we were last few weeks, since our last meeting, we had two meetings with Conservation Commission. We had planned a site visit, but because of snow, we pushed it back till this Sunday. And we met them again last week. And I submitted revised plans to Julie late last week, but I just wanted to give this opportunity for you to kind of go over a list of the changes and then continue the hearing. I know I don't expect you to come in tonight and short notice to go through the changes, but I just wanted to kind of tell where we are, go through the list of changes, and then come back in a few weeks. Did you get them all, copies of this?
Yeah.
So I'll just quickly go through if you want. I mean, quickly, if you have any questions, it's fine, you just stop me.
Can I just ask you to speak up a little bit?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. It's about 20 items or so in the list. So I'll go when, you know, it's 1 through 20, I'll write top to bottom. Number one, in the plan set, we add a landscape plan. It's sheet number 9. I don't know if you need to show it or not, but you can review it. I know it was crushed by this board about having a landscape plan, so we showed limited cut area, it'd be the last sheet. Thanks. We have this plan, it's just more detail of the proposed planting areas, details of planting themselves. And also, we show here a limit of cut line here, or disturbance in this manner, here, the heavier line. And we did locate all trees 6-inch caliper or larger on the site. Just to get an idea, you can see them here, the lighter colored ones here are the ones we cut, and the ones in the darker are the ones to be saved.
Oh, excuse me.
Yes.
If you could just clarify again, how many trees are going to be removed?
So in all, we just totaled the number of trees, and it was 27 in the 100-foot buffer. We didn't total them. I have not totaled the number of trees outside that buffer yet. But I can get that number of trees easily. Because we do look quite a tree over 6-inch caliper. Number three item on the list was the proposed limit of disturbance, the tree cut line, which we just talked about. On lot one, we reduced the driveway. We had it back pretty far before with a retaining wall. We pulled it forward a bit here to give some more privacy to the abutter over here. And remember, these houses, I spoke last time, these are boxes, these are oversized. The houses themselves probably about half the size of that, but we, in that area, we're posing decks, walkways, so it showed a bigger box. So your house probably more in this manner here, with the patio in the back. and a detail sheet, I guess you should go to sheet 3. How's sheet 4? We moved, per engineering, the force main for the sewer ran up an easement through here, but now we're moving it to the sidewalk and up to the manhole here instead of coming across here. That was per the request. We provided test hole data on sheets 2 and 5 for the groundwater elevations for the each individual house and for each individual stormwater area, minimum areas here and here. And the finals on sheets 2 and 5. On sheet 8, entering assets that we provide wall elevations for the proposed wall. That's it there. So here's part of it. Runs. This is the wall in the back. They asked us to provide elevation, top wall, bottom wall. You can see 1 foot here, 2 feet here, 3 feet, and back down to 0 here. And the wall height here, 4 feet. and just about 4 feet here. Our detail does show, which will change, to max 8 feet height. That will be max 4 feet height. That was picked up for the last, so that will be changed on a new set you'll be seeing. The proposed grading, I guess you'll be here. There was some concern about getting access to the detention pond. So what we've done, we've pulled the wall back here and flattened the grades out, so it's 3-to-1 less slope than that. So if they need be, a vehicle can get down here and access to clean out the detention pond or repair it. Before we hit the wall coming down, so it was pretty tough to get in here, so we've revised that access and actually bumped out the easement too.
So 3-to-1 is the ratio they wanted, or?
We're actually flat, we're like 4-to-1 there.
Yeah, 4-to-1.
Yeah, 3-to-1, but we flat even more than that. If we go back to the sheet four. We were asked to provide where the E1 pumps would be. We show here, it's tough to read here. Here's the pump here, the gravity-fed pump there. So each house we show where the pump is outside of the house. Gravity-fed here, and then to the sewer, force main here, which runs up the manhole up Main Street.
Those are the sewer bagger pumps?
Sewer bagger, individual pumps. So that hasn't changed, just that we showed them where they are on the plan themselves. I added a note on the plan as to the type of trees we planted. I did talk to the tree warden. He said that he wouldn't give me a specific tree this time. He said when we go to plant it at the later stages of the development, then he would meet with us and tell us what type of trees he wants on the site. But he wasn't really, didn't want to really commit at this point. So, but there's a note on the plan stating that to meet with the tree warden prior to installing the trees. On sheet 5, I provided previous calculations for each lot. Working with CONCOM, we kind of have a budget for each lot. The stormwater analysis is based on the impervious areas. So we want to make sure that each house, each lot has its own impervious maximum number associated with it. Anything over that, you'd have to provide additional site mitigation, such as the stormwater management here. And that's kind of what they were looking for, because we didn't want to always get these houses bigger or larger impervious areas that aren't consistent with our drainage design. On sheet 5, I provide cut and fill volumes that are requested by engineering. I provided a 14 square conservation revised hydraulic data sheet. Number 15, we provided upland chart area on sheet three, the plan set. It was already on there, but we just provided a chart, a little easier to read. They go to, I guess, sheet five. For number 16, you have to scroll down to. At the bottom of the driveway here, it kind of runs down here. And conservation asks us to provide an infiltration trench at the bottom here, pick up some of the runoff from the driveway. It's not a lot of area, but just enough here. So instead of just charging over the wall, the wetland is picked up here in the infiltration trench. And it's a detail we have that, I think, on detail sheet 9. Number 17, had to do with these groundwater separation between the infiltration pond. Conservation asked that we should provide 2 feet of cover, which we adjusted the grade. This is here, it was 1.9, we raised it here, so we have separation of 2 feet to the groundwater. 18, on sheet 3, we have some language on there that spells out, I think it's on the left-hand side here. We have some notations here, but it explains how the parcels and the lot areas will work. As if the surface be built through, I don't know if you see the note. Is it on the left-hand side? Yeah, right.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Right here.
It's kind of a breakdown. It also goes as part of D, but it explains how if this ever built through, as parcel A becomes lot 2A, zoom out all the way out. So this kind of is a breakdown, but.
You want me to zoom out?
Yeah, please.
Okay.
You can see here, top three. Where if this be built through to land of Reading, that parcel A would become 2A, explained over there. These two easements would become part of the roadway. Parcel B would become parcel 3B, and C would go to create lot 4C. They would all meet frontage and minimum lot size areas, if that were ever to happen. And it's kind of just a breakdown here of the math and how that all works. I've added a utility plan, profile plan, the gas and electric location. Electric is approximately right now. I did speak with Reading Light Department. They have the plans, and we're working with them to finalize the lighting and electric location. That's not shown in the plans yet, but hopefully we'll have that next time we come. We added a water, triple water gate at the entrance per engineering, and we had detail sheet 9, crosswalk details and stop bar details. So we added more details to the plan, a little more information to the plan, so it's kind of a lot to people look at. So I just kind of want to bring it together and everyone know notes here, and then come back in a few weeks to discuss some more. So any questions?
I think, well, you've covered a lot of the conservation slash infiltration, et cetera. Have you made progress on the intersection analysis?
That's one thing we do. We'll have it probably tomorrow. We were almost going to ready it today, but I told Julie I'll probably get it to tomorrow.
Okay.
Engineer did request it, so we asked for a waiver, but instead of a study, we're going to do analysis.
Yeah.
We'll have a plan with that and also a little summary of
because it is an awkward stretch of road in terms of the existing traffic.
Right. The biggest issue was the crown here, the road,
right,
and traffic coming this way. So we got the speed limits down, so we're compiled. We thought we might have it for tonight, but I'll need another half day tomorrow to finish it up.
Okay.
On that note, there was one that was done for, I forget, it's on the development off of Lowell Street.
Lyle Estates?
Yeah. That I thought did a pretty good job. Do you guys remember that? The one on Lyle Estate? The pretty good job that showed the site distances based on different stopping locations and the speeds. So if you can get him that as an example, at least on the site, the sideline analysis that
was that a plan too? They showed a plan also?
Yeah, they showed a plan,
okay.
We just saw it was that within the past month or so.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So we did a memo, but the memo, I don't think, unless you have a plan, it's tough.
Yeah.
So the memo's finished, now I'm doing a plan, because I looked at it, I'm like, well, it's tough to do that.
Yeah, so they had a plan and then just took a couple of pictures, and so it was really helpful.
I'm assuming there's only so many tree species, and you won't be surprised with some huge extra if the warden comes back with some exotic tropical mahogany. It'll all be the same caliber. And
we go back in?
I'm assuming, you said that the tree warden will get back to you on the specific street tree species.
Oh, sorry, yeah. It was with the tree one. So I was kind of pushing him with the trees he'd like to show the plan. He didn't want to commit at this time. He said, when you're ready to put them in, that's towards the end of the project. When he has as-built plans, so we can make sure we don't put trees on top of utility lines, we'll sit down with him and he'll specify which type of trees he'd like to have out there.
Okay, and that's not a cost issue for you later on, that you'll be objecting to whatever trees he selects?
No. I mean, we show a requirement of trees per, is it two per? I forget what it is. Two per lot. We have trees shown on the plan, we will have to meet that number shown on the plan. Mm-hmm. And those also tight.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Really from staff? Comments from the public? Questions? Okay. What's your schedule then? What's the next step?
Well, we're going to submit the rest of information tomorrow, and then We have a site walk this weekend, Sunday, with the Conservation Commission, and I don't know if everyone on the board wants to staked out. We have the house location staked out, still on the roadway, and the pension pond. Mm-hmm. So we're doing that Sunday at 9 o'clock, so you're welcome to come to that. Besides that, we covered a lot of issues with them. I think Conservation getting close on meeting all the requests and information they want, and hopefully we're close here. I'd like to continue the hearing to the next scheduled meeting, I guess, because right now I don't have any changes to make other than come to you for the next hearing.
Doesn't it make sense to wait for them to close and issue before you come back?
What do you?
I think that makes more sense.
Okay. Is it possible to get comments back though before with the next? I don't want to close them and still not have your comments back. Wow. I don't have to reopen theirs up. So.
Do you have any? I mean, the traffic analysis is one. Did you talk to the town engineer about sewer grinder pumps and whether the alternative might be?
I mean, versus gravity sewer.
Right.
We did, because we just talked about coming down.
Right.
And when I talked to Ryan Hussle on the phone, he said it made more sense to go this way because we can cross the brook down here. Yeah, and go under it. I think it'll be too low for gravity. So he understood what we wanted to do, why we're doing it. We didn't really prefer that, but he said it makes the most sense.
Is Conservation asking for information in the closing docs to be provided to homeowners?
Yeah, they did. Pumps.
And have you drafted that information yet?
We haven't drafted it yet, but it's,
okay, because we might want to see that language as well.
Yeah. Okay. So do we have a target date for the return to the hearing?
When's Conservation's meeting? Besides the site.
Yeah, I don't mind if you want to finish Conservation first, but I want to make sure I kind of have everything with you satisfied too. Because if they close and I come back here and it's changes, they got to reopen the hearing with them. So I don't know if that's where that's always a hard part, closing out.
Right. We've got, what, the 13th and the 27th in March.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
Yeah, and they probably have, they usually close one hearing and then issue the next. So if it's true that they're pretty much all set, then I would guess they would issue the second meeting in March, which would be before our second meeting in March.
Okay.
Other than the traffic analysis, I just had that list of questions from engineering, and if all of those have been satisfied, he covered everything I had.
Right.
I was concerned about.
Yeah, my issue with the traffic, and then the grinder pumps, and whether there is a sort of the language, or whether it made more sense to have one consolidated. Getting engineering's opinion on that, so. But that wouldn't change your, that doesn't change your site plan or anything
no,
related
it's more
to,
language.
Yeah.
Right.
So.
Even if they went to gravity, if they could somehow make gravity work, which doesn't sound like they can, all it changes is the fact that the gravity pumps go away, the grinder pumps go away, and we send the line down.
Right. The lines. Yeah, the lines still come in the same place
yeah.
as here, and we go
yeah.
this way.
Changes.
Right. Oh,
and easement language for
the access
and the trail. Do you have
a draft
of that?
So this is kind of a summary of it.
Okay.
It explains about if it ever is built out, it remains as a trail, mm-hmm. easement for parking and for access in the back.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
One thing I wanted to mention too is the park. We showed parking here, but we didn't want to line it. I think I showed a picture last time Master Place was it's not lined because once you start lining it, then you gotta have the handicapped spot and I think most we'll call it a parking lot also. I just want to keep it open and then people can if that makes sense.
It seems
yeah.
to me I didn't expect that much traffic there. Okay. Well if there's no more comments then we really want to do this on the 27th. So we have we just continue
136. So this would be second.
This would be second. So it would be a late second.
Presumably.
Okay. pretty large project.
We also have a meeting on April 3rd. I said 3rd, April 3rd.
Yeah, I was just talking about
I mean, you can come on the 27th, but I just think that meeting's going to go long.
Right? Yeah, it is.
Hey, Joe, what do you think works best? Because I think we're close. Nothing's going to really throw us a loop here.
No, I don't think
so. So there's concern about, you know, the agreement, but I think April 3rd.
It's only, I think it's just a week after the March 27th meeting. I mean, whatever. We can accommodate either day.
April 3rd, you'll be first, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it sounds better.
Move that the CBDC continue the public hearing for, I've forgotten the name of this project.
1260 and 1264 Main Street.
The Mass Equity Investments LLC, 1260 and 1264 Main Street, until Monday, April 3rd at 7:30.
Second.
All in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay, so the next thing on the agenda is a working session preparation for the 2017 November subsequent town meeting. You had that presentation, that PowerPoint presentation that we've been using for a little while.
Right.
Shows our progress for some of the items that we were taking.
Yeah. Yes. This presentation?
Yeah.
By the way, those links didn't work. I don't know if they didn't work for anybody else. I was able to download the documents, but the Google Docs didn't just open like they usually do when I click on the links.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't have any problem.
Yeah.
I got the oops message every time I tried to click on something directly. Yeah.
Which one? Was it all of them or just something?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's fine. I could still download
them. I had no problem.
They're also always on the website as well. So if it ever doesn't work.
It's easy to get them, but it's just, you know, which hand waving you use.
I was using Chrome, so
it should work.
Yeah.
I didn't go back and try to Firefox.
I don't have that one on there. Okay, so has this been updated yet?
No.
No. So we really just wanted to start the conversation since we typically do zoning in November, even though we are doing some zoning in April. November is really the time when we really want to launch anything major. And so the reason we wanted to open it up tonight is to just kind of get the conversation going about what's left, what do we think we can reasonably accomplish. We really have to make a point of sticking with our normal calendar of when things are due.
Mm-hmm.
So everything has to be done, public hearing, everything, really by August. Because unfortunately, the way the timing works, the selectmen have to close the warrant in September. So allowing at least a month before that selectmen's meeting at the end of September is critical so that we all just don't go crazy. Just nicer to avoid. So having town council weigh in and having the public hearings and all of that by really before Labor Day is the goal and the schedule. So that means backing it up between, we don't really meet in April because we're doing town meeting. It really only gives us probably about 90 days, May, June, and July, which is why we're discussing this in February.
Time flies.
Well, I think we're in pretty good shape with the stuff that we've talked about in detail so far. I mean, the commercial marijuana establishment issue is, we're pretty much under, understand what we're doing. The 40-yard district expansion the same way. I mean, there's, the signed bylaw were...
Did that last November.
Right.
Well, dump that.
At least from a constitutionality standpoint. We think, anyway.
So with that, if I can interrupt for a minute while we're on that. So we addressed the constitutionality, but there were still some, there was still a thought that it still needs to be reviewed and revised.
Yeah, we still want to make it easier, a little easier, and maybe add some flexibility, some signage.
And I don't know if that's something that we want to pick up immediately after we just revised it for constitutionality, or see how that works out. Some let that have that a little bit of time to see what sorts of issues come up before we dive right back into it.
The AG already approved it?
No, we don't
know.
We haven't gotten there.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So I guess we can jump back right back into that, but we don't even know if the last set. Was approved or works.
Yeah.
So I think it seems like that's got to be a future year.
Well, it's, yeah, I mean, gotta, if we never had to look at it again, that would be fine.
I have to look at it every day.
Well, that's good though, but if something comes up or something keeps coming up, then maybe we could address it quickly. If it really is just a simple change, that's okay. Mm-hmm. We don't want to have to reorganize it again or make a major overhaul. But we've talked about always making it simpler, right? Because we look at it like code, we know how to read code, and then there's the layperson who just looks at it and gets completely confused.
Somewhere
in between there.
But you know, even so we went through that whole process of trying to do that, but even the stuff that we write last month or whenever that was, a couple months ago, a layperson can't read it. You can't, I mean, that's the thing. That's a difficulty with it is you can't provide enough legal coverage in definition and still make it not sound like code. And, you know, it's written that way for a reason. And if other towns figure out how to do it without making it that way, we should learn that, because even as we write new language, it still comes out convoluted. I mean, sounding and reading like.
Yeah, I don't think it needs to be made so simple that, you know, that I'm not trying to get it to the point where the layperson completely understands it. What I want is consistent interpretation and application by the town staff,
yes.
So they don't have to struggle with it.
Yeah.
So
ease
that
of
person,
administration.
Yes, absolutely. That'll be a lot easier for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so signage, we're probably not doing anything there. expansion of the overlay districts, though, we've got an article for, well, actually, we're going to have a ballot question first.
Yeah.
For
overlay.
For the marijuana.
For the,
Right.
Not for the overlay.
That's right. So we've got marijuana articles. We'll have ballot questions before them. That's April. And then if we have to do something, I think those articles were all set, though. We don't, we wouldn't have to do anything, depending on the outcome of that election. Just take those two articles or the one article and
right.
know what direction we're going.
Yep.
Yep.
So yeah, right now we're really talking about November town meeting.
Yeah. It's kind of what's left question. What could we really shoot for between that we could do in 90 days to meet the deadline for November town meeting?
Well, I was jumping to the overlay districts, but if the 40R expansion passes, then we might want to consider additional design standards for sub-districts or different areas.
I've forgotten the process involved with the design standards. It's different than the zoning laws, per se.
Correct. It doesn't have to be part, it's not embedded in zoning.
Right. So we've got much more flexibility with that.
Right.
The sub-districts would just be sort of a map amendment, and then the language would be voted on by you guys.
Right. Still at a public hearing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But
well,
not a town meeting.
Do the sub-districts have to be identified in a more formal fashion, or is that just something that we could enumerate in the design guidelines themselves?
I don't think you can do anything with the map in the design guidelines. I think that has to be part of the zoning.
So if it wasn't a sub-district, if it just said Green Street design standards or this?
I think you could do design standards, but I don't think it could be technically a sub-district without it being embedded in zoning.
But we could do design standards if certain conditions, these are the design standards to use if certain conditions exist.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
That might only exist in
yep.
some particular areas of the district,
yep.
but it's not part of the map.
And that might be simpler.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I was trying to get to.
A series of lots that are only, you know, X square feet. Then we would do design standards for lots.
Grade
yeah.
change of X amount, whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
It means,
yeah.
You know, put some parameters around it. So I don't think that there's no clear need to pursue the sub-district yet.
Right.
But Nick, is what you're getting to is trying to figure out what else we have on our plate. This
yeah.
summer that
yeah.
it may not be official.
From the applications tend to slow down, then there's holidays and vacations
yeah.
and then things get spread out. So there'd be time to do some of this.
Don't mm-hmm. forget that you also need guidelines to administer the stormwater bylaw. We'll have to work on those.
Ah. Okay.
Yeah.
It's on my long list.
Okay. That's a tough one.
Maybe
come up with those.
Maybe it's not. I don't have to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if we can find a good model, that's the.
Right.
I'd be perfectly happy to plagiarize somebody who's done the work already.
Potentially, it could be very simple.
We adopted mostly the model code, our stormwater.
Yeah.
Our new
yeah.
stormwater
yeah.
bylaw is mostly the model code, right?
Yes.
Or did we just?
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so there should be somebody else's guidelines out there for us to look at.
Hmm.
I'll look into that.
Okay.
I know you guys have talked about last year, talked about looking at PRD and PUD, as well as parking. And I didn't know if you want to revive any of those thoughts.
That seemed daunting for George. You had the best grasp on all of this stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't see how that's a 90-day summer, 90-day experience.
Hmm.
I trying to remember George's conclusions or where we left it, right? Because it looked like if we were going to revise PRD,
mm-hmm.
the PUD was intertwined in it or maybe
yes.
went away.
Yes.
So
yes.
that was or the other way around.
Yeah.
It was
yeah.
also, I don't know if they were intertwined or if it was so much that we would revise it and just include language for what to do to amend the existing areas for PUD versus like creating new ones. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I think, right, part of the issue was the PRD is just so cumbersome that
right.
it doesn't make sense.
Right.
The PUD, I thought the idea was that the when those guidelines kick in seemed like it wasn't quite the right size of project either. And the idea was maybe to bring those thresholds down so
yeah.
that more people could utilize it PUD, but that we also didn't want to overlap with the PRD, and maybe it was too much for a real small project. So that's how they all got sort of intertwined, is making sure that there was potential that we didn't have projects that just couldn't be done because we got rid of one and
right.
didn't expand the other
mm-hmm.
appropriately. I think that's how it sort of got mixed. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the town is sort of in the position where mostly infill development or traditional subdivision stuff is what we're seeing, I think. The PRD and the PUD, the opportunity areas, if you will, are pretty few and far between. You know, it's a heavyweight thing, legacy, if you will, process. You know, we talked a variety of times about the PRD, which was the old cluster housing
mm-hmm.
thing. There's some of the areas, like the area up on Oakland Road, I think, was one of the ones that was where that spectacularly did not fit. But
I think, I'm not sure that PRD isn't applicable. I think that there are actually a lot of lots, because it requires just 50 feet of frontage. And we do have a lot of skinny lots that are very deep in town. So I'm not sure that it.
Well, there are
obsolete.
Areas.
Right.
Yeah.
There's a lot of process that goes on.
There is a lot of
that.
Process.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. There's a lot of process, and it's not clear from our experience with it that it addresses the issues that arise whenever somebody looks at it. Because we've got the I've forgotten what we call them, the deep narrow lots.
Shotgun.
Yeah. And there's, we haven't come up with a good way of doing anything with them,
yeah.
short of gathering up, you know, three or more and, you know, redividing it.
There is a deep lot zoning out there that we did some preliminary information gathered on.
Hmm.
And that's probably what we want to be looking at for those kinds of lots.
Well, and we've looked at that. I mean, you brought it to our attention before.
Yeah.
And it's not clear that it helps us much in the particular cases that we have.
Mm.
There's also that conversation you guys had with Jack Sullivan about common driveways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was going to bring in some more information
yeah.
about that. I think that's
yeah.
on the horizon.
Oh, yeah. I guess I would ask out loud is, you know, so there's two things here that we have sort of on that list in terms of potential addressing parking issues or trying to wrap our hands around that from a zoning perspective, and planned unit development issues. And I don't know if either of those issues are hampering growth if there are some opportunities, some other things that are limiting growth that we should be working on that we didn't sort of think of when we put this list together. I don't know, it seems to me that we shouldn't necessarily take on changing zoning unless it's really, if there's a reason, if there's a real reason to, put one in front of the other.
That's a perfect segue into introducing our economic development director, Andrew, because that's partly why he's here tonight, is so that we can make sure that our efforts are not running counter to the town's larger goals and Andrew's daily efforts.
All right, thanks, Julie. I'll try not to take up too much of your time. I think I've met each of you briefly in the past, but I'll just as a general introduction, economic development professional, I've spent the better part of 15 years practicing economic development in states like Arizona, New Mexico, where I spent about a decade, Colorado, Washington, and now I'm here in the Boston metro area. I had the fortune I was lucky enough to be able to present to the Board of Selectmen last week on the topic of defining economic development and how the definitions of that will change from region to region. So for example, in New Mexico, it was all about job creation. In Washington, it was about retail recruitment. Here, it seems to be, as far as municipal revenue generation, about property tax recruitment. So investors, property tax investors. And so I think we got a lot of work done along the lines of defining what appropriate targets would be. We recently completed the MAPC recently completed an economic development action plan, and our goals were strengthening existing businesses, attracting new ones, assisting the town's financial situation, expanding the resident base to support the local economy, and maximizing the quality of life. Again, I think the underlying factor to this is that these quality of life factors we can support by increasing the amount of revenue to provide services to the residents. I hope generally to be involved in some of the zoning and the planning processes and provide relevant input from some private sector groups that we've met with over the past, that I've met with over the past 3 months since I've been with the town, so that we are, our vision for what economic development, community development are cohesive and aligned. I did write down a few anecdotes from some recent conversations that I've had. And I think they kind of illustrate the example of how the effect of zoning and some of these changes, while good-natured and well-intentioned, sometimes have unintended consequences that can adversely affect the mission of economic development, the overall vision of the community. So I'll get into a quick couple, and feel free to interrupt make it an open conversation as you choose. Last week, Julie, myself, and Bob met with a large New England developer, Norblum, regarding opportunities in Reading. While the developer said that they were bullish on mixed-use projects in the secondary markets, they noted that affordability requirements make a big difference in profitability and project viability. Their newest project in Burlington, which was Tremont, includes 10% affordable, and the developer stated that they could not complete this project at 20% or even 15% affordable. Directly, they said that increased affordability translates to a lower end product. Parking costs skyrocket when you're sharing retail and residential. So $5,000 per parking space is about what it takes for grade, about $40,000 for podium, and $60,000 to $100,000 for underground parking. So it's expensive, but when you require parking, it gets a little complicated on some of these mixed use projects. They also said that it's harder to finance some of those high retail requirements. The lending institutions perhaps don't see that industry segment as bullish as they do residential real estate at this point. They also said to be very cognizant of what time and what the burden of actually permitting some of these mixed-use projects was to a developer, and said that on average, permitting costs range around $50,000 to a developer per unit of mixed use. So that was the direct economic, tangible monetary value of actually permitting these. So I think we have good opportunity to provide some real value in limiting the amount of financial burden we put these private industry sector developers under. We met with another real estate broker we have a relationship with that brought a developer in that was talking about a proposed project in the 40R expansion area. Developer has extensive mixed use in the Boston metro area. They asked specific questions focused around density and affordability. Once again, town staff relayed that the affordability requirement for the rental development aspect would be raised from 25% to 25% from 20%. The broker stated while the affordability requirement was understandable and well-intentioned, he's intimately aware of 40B and the 10% goal that we have, as well as the motivation for it. He said that the affordability requirement effectively is a tax on land to the actual owners, and it's an additional hurdle for investment and redevelopment. He said that the client that they brought in determined that without a significant increase in the density, which would bring parking issues to the forefront, and a substantial height waiver, the project wasn't economically feasible, and so they decided to look elsewhere. So I want to say that and just make sure that while we are in the process of coordinating some of these new zoning bylaws, that do we take into consideration what impacts some of these rules have on our ability to attract investment going forward. The other general observations that we've had just recently is that this residential real estate boom is the primary driver for a lot of these projects right now, and I'm not sure how long we can bank on that. There are signs of a market slowdown. Financial institutions are starting to pull back from financing projects. Loans in the years past would cover approximately 65%. They're reduced to 55% now, and there's also been an increase in mezzanine financing in other areas that are more expensive for developers. In 2017, 378,000 apartment units are expected to be delivered. It's a 30-year high. That adds to the supply glut. And apartment rents rose 3.8% in 2016, down from 5.6% last year. And there's actual declines in apartment rents in cities like San Francisco, San Jose, New York, Houston, and others. All this while construction costs keep rising. And your consumer is more sophisticated, and they demand certain types of amenities when looking for apartments or condos or even houses. Millennials and empty nesters have certain expectations, I think, that maybe your traditional home buyer or renter didn't have. So we need to be aware of that. Speaking directly of 40R, I think that there's real positive benefits, and then when I initially looked at it, I thought it was an economic development tool that we'd be able to use to attract investment. It gives additional flexibility in the use of residential and mixed in areas that weren't previously zoned for that, and ability to grant waivers on restrictions should the circumstances demand it. But there were the cons from a private side perspective. The increased affordable requirement, again, reduces the value of the land for the owners. It acts as a deterrent for investment. And using residential as a driver for growth is really not an inevitability. One of the things I mentioned to the Board of Selectmen last week was that I've come from markets where residential actually went down. Since I've been doing this before, you know, 2005, you've seen ebbs and flows, and maybe we lose a little bit of perspective here in a metro area like Boston with a thriving, you know, economy generally. And I want to make sure that we understand that this isn't an inevitability, and that residential demand can be reduced. And if so, that's a big carrot that we have from an economic development standpoint, particularly in these 40R projects. With the limited available real estate that we have, 8% commercial, I think it's really important for us to take advantage of the opportunities when they arise. And that economic development is multifaceted, requires a cohesive strategy. It's a team sport. One hand needs to know what the other is doing. And so I'm really encouraging you to consider the vision of the community when you're making changes to zoning and design standards, specifically how they would affect the ability of the town to attract the desired investments that we mutually agree upon. and I really look forward to contributing to the process, whenever possible, and being able to provide some private sector perspective from some of the meetings that I have. So I'm hoping I'm going to be able to add some value to the process as you go through doing these important changes, and I welcome any feedback, and I feel like I'll be able to be your eyes and ears from a private sector perspective when I'm out there at some of these meetings.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Welcome to the game.
Thank you.
Welcome to our game.
Yeah. And so up on the screen here, I have a map that Jean and I put together prior to a meeting that we had with the state about some funding to help spur housing and economic development in the Walkersburg area.
We were lucky enough to have the Secretary of Housing and Economic Development, Jay Ash, have a meeting up at the State House with him, thanks to some of our legislative team, and Brad Jones was especially helpful in putting that together. And so we realized that we needed to go to the state with an ask. And we thought, okay, well, what is our ask? And when we started thinking about this idea that Reading is at a crossroads, and we know that we have to work hard to advance what we have in front of us, which is a structural deficit in the budget. We went to the taxpayers, and there was a resounding no when it came to Proposition 2.5 override. So we've always talked about a strategy to grow ourselves out of this hole that we're in, this deficit that we're in. And so we started thinking broadly about, you know, some of the things that we've been talking about in our economic development plan, some of the things that we are already seeing with investment in projects in the downtown. And we thought it's such a compact area that when we put it all on a plan, it started to somehow make some kind of sense. And with a little more tweaking and connectivity to these different development areas, we thought this could really be a redevelopment plan, and certainly something that's driven by, as I say, projects that are already in the queue, as well as some that are still in the thinking stages. And so obviously infrastructure is a big component of this, but the one connection that you can see on the map is how close Walker's Brook is to downtown and to our commuter rail station. And we know that our commuter rail station is a very busy station. It's the busiest station of all of them in the area communities. We studied this with Wakefield and with Melrose. Now granted, we only have one station, but it has the highest utilization. And so that's a hub, and that's a strength that we have that we really should be considering, and we have considered when we did the zoning for the downtown Smart Growth District. And hopefully we can leverage that even more by expanding that district. But when you look at how, again, the geography of how close that is to Walker's Brook, where there already is a tremendous amount of development, and this exercise gives us the opportunity to again solidify where are we okay with development. And by development, to Andrew's point, not just our regular garden variety projects that we're used to seeing. These are bold projects that we know we have to think about because the financing doesn't work otherwise. And so, for example, the future affordable housing area that we have flagged on the map, that's something that potentially could be very bold and provides an opportunity for us to think about how much housing could we support there. It's a big area. It's sort of backs up to a very heavy commercial district with Jordan's Furniture right behind it and that tremendous grade change. And then you look at some of the orange circles up on the map, and you see how the infrastructure to support that kind of development really needs to be looked very closely at. And that's really the message that we brought to the state, is that in order for us to go bold with some of these development options, we need their help with infrastructure and realigning some of these areas, the intersections and roadway alignments. We know Lakeview Ave could never handle it the way it's laid out today if we're talking something on a pretty large scale. So in partnership with the state, this is potentially a very feasible plan. The question that we have to keep asking ourselves is, are we ready for this? Are we ready to embrace this kind of a change, this difference in thinking about, you know, maybe we need to have another commuter rail station on Walkersboro or on New Crossing Road, and that's the circle down here. We talked about a pedestrian overpass. We talk about a flag stop platform, again, to support development along here. We know that this whole area is really ripe for something more. We have single-story commercial for the most part, but there's no reason that we should stop there. Down in this area where the DPW is, there's potential for some different thinking about that. This whole area, we put in the pedestrian funicular, and that was the town manager's idea. But it's true that we have a sea of parking here behind Jordan's Furniture, hundreds and hundreds of parking spaces and pavement. And if we're talking about development adjacent to this, again, with that tremendous grade change, it wouldn't be out of the realm of possibilities to think about a way to link those two areas so that we don't have to keep spending more money on pavement and parking, and we can actually see development.
One quick note on that. I'll say that when we did meet with the developer, and this highlights the importance of the mission you know, the CPDC have, is that you know, if we were able to create a real estate asset, I know that there's been talk of potentially redeveloping some of the land down there. But what the market would demand may not be what's in the vision of the town. One of the things we heard is that if there was 5 acres available for development, the highest cost for that land would probably be from a developer looking to do single-story flex use industrial buildings. It would get leased up at the highest rate. So making sure that we're proactive and pragmatic in the process of creating some of these zoning changes, I think, is important, and that we all have the same goal of increasing the quality of life and increasing some of the municipal revenue that the town derives.
So which came first, the zoning or the developer?
Well, there's, I mean, as you mentioned, the talking to the state and the DOT is something. I mean, I've been living in Reading since mid-80s and watched a lot of the stuff, a lot of the changes going on. And everybody who lives here knows where the choke points are. They know where the map or the map of movement from place to place breaks down. And, you know, the Washington Street and Main Street intersection is a classic example. And the New Crossing Road, I mean, if we gave up the Ash Street crossing, you know, there's some things. There's a fair amount of the transport web or movement web, which has been particularly difficult to do anything about. You know, Reading is surrounded by movement barriers. We've got the interstate highways, we've got the rail line, we have the substantial wetland constraints. You know, there's some of the, something I've been watching with interest, I haven't figured out exactly how it'll matter, is they're talking about the new Boston Road Bridge over Wilmington Woburn, which is going to change some of the access opportunities. You know, if we could, we talked in one of the zoning proposals was the, talked about the Pond Meadow Drive, the paper street. You know, if there were connectivity that didn't have to come all the way up to Washington Street, you know, you could have with a lot of more opportunity. And that's something that the town can't do it by itself, I don't believe.
No.
So it's good to hear that we're reaching out to the state and the other involved parties. The Walker's Brook is a wonderful place, but we are subject to the environmental constraints working on the capped landfill. And there's only a certain amount of change that we can do there. I'm not sure what the horizon is on easing those restrictions.
Yeah, I think we're talking more on this side of Walker's Brook.
Yeah. Well, it's one of the things that I have at on the web, if you will, is the USGS survey map from 1951, which shows Redding, which is probably 60% wetland, with Route 128 and none of the North-South highways. And it's fascinating to look at that occasionally and compare it to the map that we see in the town today. And that's one of the, it's some of the geological boundaries, if you will, that we're dealing with.
Did you have something? Did you want to say something? I wasn't sure.
I mean, I guess I just wanted to get your feel on your appetite for trying to do something more flexible for the PUDI is, or something more like a form-based code.
Zoning is a tool used to get to a certain development type.
Mm-hmm.
I have a good understanding of where we want to head in the downtown, and we've tried to use a tool to get there. Maybe we still need tweaks on that tool. Maybe there are other tools to get the downtown. I think parking is probably one of those things that needs to be addressed in there to further that district, even if it's the expanded, or especially with the expanded district. I don't have a sense of where we are really trying to get in other non-residential sections of town. What's that vision? What's that look like? Is it more higher density housing? Is it more of a neighborhood? Sort of, when I've done this in other places, because I've done this professionally, as I think maybe Nick you have too, but you forget about some of the things that we have, sort of the constraints, the wetland constraints, some of the huge constraint on that huge, enormous Walker's Brook crossing area. But what would this area look like? And then, okay, then load in the constraints and how do you deal with those? And then look at the tool and how to get to that location. I don't think if we need to make a big change, we can't be cautious about, sort of making the little, maybe it does make sense to connect Pondview Drive through, but in order to get that through, you sort of have that vision.
Right.
of what would that do? What big thing would that do? Because everyone can figure out what big thing that does in the negative way. We need to also present what big thing that does in the positive way. And I it's not a criticism. I just don't know. I don't know what that vision is. I you know, like 10 things, 10 different approaches pop up in sort of these non-commercial, these non-residential commercials sections of town, which aren't downtown. I mean, there's this that we're talking about, but there's also, you know, the area sort of that further up Main Street that we could also talk about. But yeah, to just looking at this map is interesting because, you know, that huge General Way develop area is, that's an enormous site. And it's not used all that well. I mean, well, they struggle getting our tenants in there. And
well, because it's hard to get to and hard to get out of.
Yeah, but it doesn't have to be, I guess. And it, so, you know, maybe there's.
Do you think that's why that's the way it is?
What, hard to get into? And
yeah, you think it's an access issue? I mean, I just think he's maxing out what he has, and he's not too worried about making some super huge development there. If you had the right zoning in that area, that's ripe for vertical, right? That's way too low for that area. That needs to be vertical. And it's the one place that could support it. I don't think anyone would complain about it.
That right, but the approach by that property owner has been, well, and I, or at least it appears to me, is that I don't want to invest too much.
No.
I just want to sell what I have there. Which means those buildings and, you know, sort of tinker around with the building layout, not get rid of the building and redo the entire site and change it into something that it isn't.
Actually, he came in and asked for permission to demolish the pulled back portion of that, right? Mm-hmm. So they're looking to reduce square footage.
Exactly right.
Into that facility.
Demo the back.
Yeah.
But also one of the things that there was the battle over the triangle. Access from the New Crossing Road into the One General Way, and they lost that battle.
But that was right. That was just battle, so that those same, you know, so that the liquor store could get more traffic by it. I mean, there's nothing. He's never presented anything transformative there, right? As far as I know, it's reused that same building. Set of
actually, it was a beautiful building. I know it's sort of running down, but you know, in my architectural opinion, the bland, you know, stuccoed storefront is not as nice as that industrial brick aesthetic that they had, which would be expensive to rehab, obviously.
I think a lot of the challenges, specifically on that site, are accessibility from a retail perspective. So it's out of, you know, all the traffic is on Walker's Brook, and so it's kind of out of sight, out of mind for retail.
Right. It can't be a retail. Right. It can't be a great, thriving retail location. Mm-hmm. It's got to be a destination location, someplace that you're. But it's a fantastic site in terms of it's right off of 120, off of 95, not too far from 93, but not overlooking the highway. Yeah. I mean, it's.
Well, for the right
type of redevelopment, it's fantastic.
Yeah, and the area between the RMLD and the railroad is a companion thing. That's it's one of the areas that we focused on. I forgot what we called the charrettes or the meetings we had.
Yeah, we had community forums. As part of the Economic Development Action Plan, we had a number of community forums, and we really focused on that area as priority development area number 3. We did some visualization.
And as you mentioned, I mean, the high value of the light industrial. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would be fabulous to have, you know, two-story kind of stuff in there, but there is an access issue. You know, where that if we were able to get the secondary commuter rail access and work, tweak the MBTA bus routes to even in simpler things.
So I'm going to just wait a second. There's plenty of TMAs out there that can fix all of these issues once you get the right developer in here. They're all sort of out there waiting for the wings, waiting to come knock at your door to bring new bus routes and shuttles and whatnot around here.
Absolutely.
To your point, I work with a bunch of leasing brokers who actually just went to some sort of real estate roundtable that said that the investment markets, particularly for residential, are moving out to the outer suburbs because the Boston and Cambridge markets are so saturated. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't mean it's the Cab Captain Forbes or the Rubensteins or the JLLs of the world. It could be the Winds or the Intercontinentals or the Pinnacles. Maybe that's our sites are even too small for those guys. You got to go a little lower, like the Maggiore's and some of those guys around here. So I'm going to urge you to sort of steer away from the Class A guys and broaden and go a little bit smaller and sort of pull out of the Boston real estate market to sort of broaden what we're doing out here.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's two different things that I was talking about, particularly mixed use and residential multifamily development, which I think our focus is in the downtown Smart Growth District. And I do think that we're going to be smaller scale, you know, your post office guys, your local developers, your secondary folks. The other opportunity, I think that needs some creative visioning from selectmen, from CPDC, from a lot of the other community stakeholders, is trying to identify what we could do if, from a redevelopment standpoint, if real estate assets were to be realized, the DPW site, RMLD, Frame Corporation, Datus Development. I think that there is an opportunity there. It's more for larger master plan development and or single tenant, which I think are challenging from a recruitment standpoint on a single tenant. Identifying those tenants is challenging. It's very competitive. A lot of the communities are going to be aggressively pursuing those high-profile tenants. And so I don't have an answer what we need to do in this industrial area, but I think that the goal would be to increase density or increase value, property values.
Right.
Mm-hmm. How we accomplish that, I'm not sure. It'll depend on what the market will be able to support, and so the zoning code that we come up with collaboratively, I think, will impact what our abilities will be down there too.
Yeah, the DPW lot. That's not a project that could be undertaken simply by selling that land, right? Given the current budget issues. We'd still have to put money into a new DPW facility, I would imagine. Or are you saying that the property value could be increased so high that we could build a DPW facility on that cost alone?
I don't know how we get there, but I'd certainly think that the realization of an asset down there for municipal revenue is enticing.
I know, but if we can't, if we don't have the funds to build a DPW facility, selling the property does us no good, which means that no matter what we plan for that, it's nowhere near short term. It's who knows how far down. So that whole parcel, that whole area is dead until you can tell me how we could build a new DPW facility somewhere and where that money's going to come
from. If that's truly in the way of a developer that wants that land, they will pay it for you. I'm not saying it's big enough to do that.
Yeah, that's what I'm just not.
You, pay you
yeah,
money.
I don't know where you're going
to
get $27 million to build a new DPW facility.
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. I know the state has been looking at the 128-93 interchange for many years, the goal being to eliminate a lot of those car traffic. It just looks to me that that's almost a perfect place to put up a parking garage and move the, if not move, but add in the train stop. There's at least three tracks there, so you can actually have multiple trains coming. The state might want to invest in putting a some sort of transportation center there, get a lot of that road traffic off of the interchange and into Boston.
So some sort of multimodal bus rapid transit, parking structure.
Which may have the benefit of the state then coming in, helping correct some of these intersections that are overburdened, maybe correct the Walkers Brook North Ave 128 interchange. Just something that might happen.
That's a good thought. The
that's way down the line. I guess we have to decide what we want in the sort of 5, 10, 20 year outlook. I don't know what the Board of Selectmen has been talking about for their for how extended a plan you want. Obviously, you have to think about the entire future of the town, but zoning could have some immediate impact. What are those projects?
Well, I don't think that those projects have to be decades away at all. I mean, we've talked about things that are, obviously you've got to clear some space, but it is not unreasonable to say that there are certain developers that have, that we've had discussions already. I mean, you've got to stop to think about what we, there's a lot of things that we offer here. High energy users, for example.
Right.
We have the cheapest electricity, maybe in New England, but you know, certainly in the state. Another thing to consider is, I mean, when you think about projects like this, it's energy, it's location, it's transportation. And
right.
We actually have all three, which is interesting. They're in raw form at the moment. And what you know, you have to tie. What you have to think about is this grand vision that you guys are talking about is not so. I don't believe that it's a fantasy land discussion at all, because you see that when you see it on the map there, you have to put aside the immediate constraints that all of us that have lived in Reading for any length of time realize. Oh no, you can't get there from here. Well, of course you can't today. The kinds of conversations that Gene and the team have had, you know, with Jay Ash about infrastructure. Now I realize that we're talking about a little different space on that discussion, but I think to this gentleman's point, the state is very interested in modernization and redevelopment. And transportation is part of that, location is part of that, you know, proper utilization of energy is all part of that, access to Boston. We've actually got kind of all of that going on right there. So their willingness to talk to us, I mean, has been clearly demonstrated already. It's not that they've got, you know, bags of money they want to drop on Reading, because they don't, but investment in certain infrastructure is kind of an investment in the state, so it's not like it turns out really good for Reading when that happens. But it, I mean, it's not like, oh, well, the state's gonna drop money on us. It's, you gotta take, we all have to take that out of our head, because that's kind of not the way it works. But infrastructure's not giving us money. Infrastructure's creating something that they win at too, which is really, I think, I love that you guys are having this discussion tonight. I think that it's a really forward-thinking discussion. Andrew's here to fuel the fire, which is great. So I think that you don't need to think about this decades away. I think you should think about your zoning with an eye towards people who are working hard alongside of you, including the Board of Selectmen. I know Barry's here tonight. He's involved working with the economic development strategy that we're heading up, and you know, Andrew's on the team now, so we're kind of, I mean, I don't know, Barry, I feel like we're full steam ahead on the thought process and where we go, and some of it's more than just thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about, I mean, for the first time we're having conversations with developers about what we would like to see rather than what, like with our 40Bs, they just come and say, well, this is what we're going to do here. So the fact that we've spent the last couple of years planning and did a lot of work with the community, sort of figuring out where are our opportunities, and now we're actually going out and saying, what can we do here? And trying to recruit people and ideas for that, I think is positive. You look at that map, I mean, it just, all that stuff is so close to downtown. So it's really not sort of some outlying development district that we're talking about, we're talking about knitting it right in the middle of the community. And if you look at all that potential empty space, you know, if we could look where the department, where the DPW was, you know, just envision what could go there if that wasn't there. You know, I mean, it's...
It's eight of the most prime acres in Reading.
You're less than half a mile away from an interchange. You know, you can think about hotels, you can think about office buildings, you can think about the kinds of things that would generate revenue and not take up a lot of services.
Yeah.
You know, we can build, you know, just before we had, you know, a subdivision for five houses. You know, in my mind, I'm calculating, you know, at $8,000 to $10,000 a house, you know, that's $40,000, but if seven kids move in there now, we've net lost in terms of what we're spending on services versus what we're getting in tax dollars. This is the kind of thing where we can get tax dollars and not have to expend a lot of services, so it's a net win. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's like a blank canvas, and we generated a lot of ideas, and we certainly want the zoning to facilitate to bring in what we want, as opposed to having someone say, well, this is what we're going to do, and then the zoning chases the project. So, and ultimately, the developer, you know, we can say we can do anything we want. We can wish for anything that we want, but ultimately, someone's got to come in and pay and invest the dollars in it. And, you know, it is disappointing to have a developer say, well, right now, you know, a single-story flex-use property for some of the prime development is the best that we're going to do. That's incredibly disappointing.
Seems like we would be talking to the wrong person if that's the best use.
Right.
Because, frankly, I mean, you know, Barry and I have talked about this. The five of us have had a similar conversation to the one you all are having, which is, I think, really powerful. And we know what we need to do, and we know that that's kind of why we've enjoyed joint meetings with you before. What we need to do is think about this, the impact of whatever we do should be lasting out 40 and 50 years. I mean, that's what we have to be thinking about, financial sustainability in a different way than thinking about, oh my God, is the state gonna send us some more money for the schools next year? I mean, you know, we keep waiting for that, that's not gonna happen. So
that's only going to get worse.
That is only going to get worse. However, if you said to the state, we want to create some infrastructure that's going to take care of a whole series of things, housing, transportation, good use of energy, you have a whole different ear when you're having that discussion. So I would urge you to think about your zoning work in the nearer term rather than the further term. I just think that you're going to have the support of the Board of Selectmen in that regard. I mean, that is where we're pointed. And the idea of a single-story flex building, you've got to be kidding me. You know, I can't picture that for the life of me. Barry, I'm sure you'd probably agree with
no,
that.
No, I mean, that's when we had those discussions going back a year and a half. And I mean, you look at that, this is our last best chance for expanding the economic pie in Reading. I mean, you'll have a one-off project here and there, which, you know, someone will come in and want to do something, and it'll be nice, but that's not gonna grow the pie. This will grow the pie.
Right.
I mean, we're not gonna grow our way out of economic, out of fiscal problems. I mean, we're not that kind of town, but what we can do is this kind of thing can sustain and delay the time when we have to go to the taxpayers and say, now we need more money for schools, more money for police and fire. This will expand that.
We're probably headed on a merry-go-round of every 3 years, you know. If we don't go forward in a way that makes productive revenue sense, like the things that, you know, we're all talking about tonight, we will be on a never-ending merry-go-round of, you know, every 3 or 4 years, it's like, how are we gonna fund this? How are we going to add two more policemen? How are we going to add, how are we going to retain, you know, the foreign language program? We have got to stop that cycle. We've got to break that cycle. And, you know, Nick, I think you brought up a fair question. Like, oh my God, where are we going to find the money to move the DPW? Well, I mean, that's a fair question with not such a simple answer, but it is more manageable. It's a different look at how you do things. You do it on a collaborative regional basis. It changes the cost structure. We do continue, because of good fiscal management of our resources, have exceptionally good borrowing power. I mean, there's a lot of ways to skin that cat, and we can't let that. If that's the stop sign, okay. But we can't think about it as a stop sign until it becomes one. I think we have to continue to process other site locations, which we are in the middle of doing, and kind of see where it goes. I think you should be aggressive in looking at this as near-term work.
Just a little anecdote, for my job, I'm a consultant. I do planning, a lot of transportation, but some planning consulting, I worked on a project. This is probably, I'm going to say, about 7, 8, 9 years ago, down in Newport, Rhode Island, where it was a project that looked a lot like this area here that we're talking about, where they had a DPW yard, and believe it or not, Newport, Rhode Island doesn't have a lot of redevelopment area.
A lot of big houses out there.
Yeah, they got lots of houses, lots of big houses, and a small downtown for them. And so they're looking for more space, more locations to redevelop. They identified the DPW space along with a highway interchange that coming off the big bridge there, right, that sort of went into nowhere and was sort of wasted land, plus the casino, some
Wood River.
Yeah, Wood some River. Yeah. And some space there that wasn't used all that well. And I'm telling you this story because they went out and hired this consulting team, and what we did was we came up with a vision for this area, and addressed things like what was the economics of moving the DPW yard? How would that, what kind of space, I mean, interviewed the DPW folks, got into the detail of exactly what would we need to replace, how much would it cost, what are some sites in town that could go, what's the pro forma for that, what's the market look like, what kind of development could come in, what are they looking for, what kind of space are they looking for, and then took the whole transportation network and we blew it up and redid it and conceptually. And then, so we created this vision and then built up a way to get there. Zoning, some funding mechanisms, working with the state to redo roads and roundabouts and all that sort of thing, which is a lot like what we're talking about here. I think that we probably have could cobble the skills together to do that here, but that takes a lot of time to get it right.
Right.
I would just have to say, it's great. We now have a bunch of people who now know how to do this, which is wonderful. This is probably the number one priority of the Board of Selectmen. So, we have to get this right.
Yeah.
And so, whatever it's going to take is what we're going to do. I mean, we didn't have the money, but yet we found money to hire an economic development director, because we didn't have the skill set and the bandwidth
to
figure it out. And so, this will have the attention and full support of the Board of Selectmen to get it right.
So where I told you that whole story was, we as a board could nibble around the edges playing with zoning. We're likely to get it wrong because we're not thinking big enough and transformative enough.
Exactly.
And so, if this is a powerful map in seeing
how much space there is here and what the potential is. And you know, if you did like an opportunities map here, this would be a fantastic area. But I think to do it justice and to really reap the benefits of that, we need to think sort of transformative. And I don't think that can just be this board or just the Board of Selectmen or, you know, just town staff. I think we need to, I think there's an opportunity here for this area to sort of come up with a different, what's that, you know, the thing, if we keep doing the same thing, we're going to get the same results.
Well, I think you're right, John. I think we do need to continue to step outside of ourselves mm-hmm. and outside of our comfort zone. The way we get there, I mean, I'm so glad that we're having this discussion tonight. And, you know, as you know, we've welcomed joint meetings before. I do think that the discussion will spawn what you're calling for, because it needs to be transformative. Mm-hmm. It's like go big or don't bother here. You know, it's kind of what it is. Mm-hmm. It really is, because Barry points out very correctly that I agree with him that this is the number one issue in front of the selectmen and the number one issue going forward, actually for several years. And the reason it's so important, I mean, we're hearing about, you know, shortage of funds for schools, and those are all very real, and we're trying to address those. But the root problem is, you know, the voters are saying, oh my God, I can't take on anymore. So when they say that to guys like Barry and I think to all of us, we have to think in a transformative way so that, and you know, that may cause us to need to do what you're suggesting, John. And I don't personally don't think we're far away from making that decision. I mean, we made a decision in our last budget cycle, not the one we're currently in, but a year ago. I mean, Barry and I and the other selectmen sat there and went, no, we're finding a way to hire somebody who can help us, because we can't, you know, the spirit was willing, you know, but the flesh was weak. We needed help. And so we found it. And that was kind of a little picture of that. I mean, a little piece of what we're talking about here, but we have to continue to forward the discussion so that the vision grows. And then we take that next step, because I think you're right. You know, we've got a lot of talent, but there's limitations. So, you know, everybody's got to go to work.
Yeah.
Well, almost everybody, except me.
but that's a reason. Guys here.
Didn't mean to monopolize your meeting. Please,
no,
felt like good. You were asking us though.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, one point that. We have to pay attention to things that which are off of our map. There's a lot of competition. Mm-hmm. We've got the Lake Quanapoet area, the developments, Wakefield Office Park in there. We've got the, I can never remember the name of the road, it's like the one up to the exit 37C over in Woburn, and all of the development in that corridor.
Where the transportation center used to be.
We've got the River Park, I mean, a company that I used to work for, just on the other side of our town forest. And it's not a problem that is unique to Reading. We have a very good position, but we also have to pay attention to who we're competing against.
Yes.
I happen to think that the Market Street fit better in Linfield than it did down where Reading Wood is. That's not necessarily a popular opinion. But the biggest areas looking at this map that we have to look further out is Camp Curtis Guild, for one, and the golf course, for example. I mean, areas that the rest of it we're talking about competing against major players. Stoneham, Woburn, Wakefield, Wilmington, I mean, they're all in the same game. So we have to pay attention to that as much as what the opportunities inside our own boundaries are.
That's true, but other than Market Street, they aren't destinations, right? I mean, the development's over by Woburn, okay, you run over to Target or whatever, you go to that mall, whatever's left there. Not some place that this could become if it was envisioned as some whole piece.
Less than half a mile from you downtown.
Right. It is about building destination.
And if it had that multimodal transportation hub there, right, then that would probably spur it pretty well. You know, the stuff over by the lake, that seems underutilized as well.
Definitely.
Right? That's nothing attractive about anything there. It's just
right,
usable office space, I guess.
And the new building that's going up on North Ave, which I was told by someone I know in real estate that it was going to be Hallmark Health, it's going to be residential.
Yeah, it's residential. So.
It is going to be residential.
It's crazy. I was kind of shocked when I heard, oh my gosh, Hallmark Health would build over on Lake Conopowit. You know, we've missed the boat. And then I said, oh no, it's residential.
Which, I mean, Lake Conopowit is a big draw for exactly that market.
But it's not missing the boat on residential.
No, but it's going right next door to all those automobile dealerships, and it's all commercial, and then a new building going up is residential. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you just drive down Main Street in Stoneham, and then, you know, look east, and what you've got is multifamily apartment blocks as far as the eye can see. That's not something that we necessarily want.
Do you think that, so these claims that we hear from the developers all the time, not to track this out, nobody can build anything apparently.
Take what they say with a grain of salt.
I take exception to the statement that it's $50,000 per unit for permitting. How much of that is mandatory building code stuff? You know, is anyone going to argue that the building code is over-regulating? Maybe the electrical guy.
I don't like that.
Well, don't give me 4-foot
suites. Depending on the town.
Right. So, you know, some of that is sort of inherent in the project. Some of it might be over-regulation by some other agency. So is the town willing to accept a 50 to 70 unit 40B every year and not put in affordable housing to give developers what they want?
Well, I mean, you know, the project that Gene talks about could for 10 years solve our problem. And that would be an enormous step. Nothing's ever going to solve that problem permanently because Massachusetts will not allow that to happen. However, we would be one of a very small handful of communities that could potentially solve their imbalance with the right kind of transformational thinking, you know, that transformational thinking literally, Gene, you have to correct me if I'm wrong, but you could be putting shovels in the ground pretty soon around that project. And it could transform the affordable housing issue, which could then speak to the issue that Andrew brought up, which you want to do some attractive. You start adding the pieces, Dave, to your point about the competitors.
Mm-hmm.
So if suddenly what you have is energy and location and transportation, and you also have this little thing being one of the very smallest handfuls possible of towns that have already solved their affordable housing situation for mixed use going forward. It does start to blunt the competition.
Right.
I mean, it really does, because now you really have got this whole bag of goodies here, you know, when you get inside the confines of Reading. And I actually think that's not far-fetched thinking at all. Gene, you'll probably tell me if I'm cracked, but.
No, I mean, it, when you really start to look at it on a map and you see the opportunities and you see how the sites, these sites cannot be individually thought of. They have to be thought of together, which is what a lot of what we do here is thinking more broadly. How can we share parking across sites? And how can we think differently about how there's movement between the different areas of the town, different neighborhoods? How can we get people out of their cars? How can we really do some bold things and not just think about a site and it needs this much parking and it's its own site? Because that doesn't get us where we need to go. We need to go to what John said earlier, deconstruct all those boundaries and just think broadly and think big, because that's the only way we're going to get to the goals that we have in front of us to reach our 10% affordable housing so we can be done with 40B, done for a decade, done and done.
And, you know, done in a really positive way, because the affordable housing is here. So then you've got workforce availability, which is, I mean, now you start to really solve the problem. You know, I mean, it really kind of is, it's keystone work. It's the stuff that unlocks, you know, potential investors and makes them really interested. And you have a story to tell.
And we may not be done with affordable housing in terms of the needs of the community, but if we're done with 40B and somebody comes in and wants to do a friendly 40B on our terms, the way we think it could work, or what's good for Reading, that's a completely different conversation.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And also, too, if you think about the time and energy that was spent on the Lincoln Street 40B, which was the anti-friendly 40B. It was the unfriendly 40B. And the time that Julie and Jean and the selectmen and the zoning board to get a project that went from totally unacceptable to at least manageable.
Right.
Just think of the time, what their time could have been spent in working with Andrew and with us to sort of figure, be more proactive and get the things we want to do. So it has a cascading effect of, you know, if we can just check that box off, it would be incredibly helpful.
So do you think that there's something here that we could attack in this time period, or is this just a longer
term? Well, I think what I'm hearing is, let's think about whether or not we can get the right experts to guide this. And I don't know what that would cost. I don't, you know, forget about what the cost and what the money and all that. But let's think about that.
I think you have to put that over on the side for a minute so you can, you know, think about what's possible.
Yeah.
I think your engagement in the actual process of visioning, alignment of goals, and just thinking creatively about what could be done down there, engaging in the whole conversation is really important. You are experts in your own specific industries, and your insight is valuable. And as we think of creative ways to solve a myriad of different issues the town is facing, I think not losing sight of the goal of reaching our 10% and creating a good smart growth district and expanding that and redeveloping higher density, better uses, I think all those are important, but just engagement is really helpful for us as we envision what could be potentially down there. And we'll iron out the details afterwards, I guess.
But yeah, I guess I do think that really, you know, what I described was digging deep into the details, which would need to be done. But I guess I think that what we first need to do is create that vision or sets of visions. There may not be one, but to see, you know, if this area was redeveloped as mixed-use housing, how would that fit into the other goals? What would that do for our municipal budget?
Help a lot.
We can start to, you can run the numbers at a sketch plan level.
Sure.
And sort of start to do that. I think, you know, whether we can get
someone to facilitate a, you know, a charrette or two and sort of run through those ideas, sketch some stuff up, and, you know, sort of what we did a little bit, like on South Main Street at one point,
right?
Is sort of lay up some ideas and see how they looked when you really sort of put some,
you know,
some meat to them.
You haven't even strayed from this marvelous piece of land right here to even talk about the fact that you got South Main Street to do with. I mean, there are really that MAPC plan, you know, that study was eye-opening. I mean, you know, and all three of those have come up tonight. All three of those areas I identified. This is the obvious one that, you know, that grabs you. But you guys have already wrestled the whole approach with the expanded smart growth district that's going to end up in front of town meeting, which is kind of the other big area. And, you know, and then the third one is South Main Street. And you guys have already done some brainstorming in that regard. I think we have to think that way, and we have to decide what kind of resources we need. And Gene, I don't know that maybe there aren't some, maybe we should be talking to Jay Ash, and maybe we should be talking to our legislative caucus and see what help is available. And there may be none, and that's okay. Then we understand what we're up against. So, 'cause you're right, John. I mean, that's the only thing that's going to get us there. It's going to have to be deeper than part-time volunteers thinking this is a good idea.
I mean, we'd all love to do it, but like you said, we do need to get to work.
It doesn't get there that way.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think we should be aggressive, and we've got an extra player here. There was some talk, and I don't know what the current status is, of the MTA extending the dual track all the way up to the downtown station. Now, if we were going to strike while the iron is hot, I guess, is one thing. If we could talk them into leaving the double track where it is, which happens to be New Crossing Road,
right,
and putting in an extra station instead of extending the track.
Which is probably cheaper.
Exactly.
The dual track is not a good thing for our downtown.
No.
That's right.
Yeah,
saying.
So what
and
happens?
Getting a dual track into downtown would be very disruptive if you look at where it goes.
Right.
Well, the real thing that's disruptive is that with the second track, you have a train sitting there, idling there pretty much all day. So I think the rest of it is probably not that big of a deal.
There used to be three tracks down there.
What's that?
There used to be three tracks downtown.
But there is a big interest on the T operations to be able to run that, just that section, just from across, you know, Ash Street and Main Street into the station, so that they have more flexibility in operating that line. But yeah, the downside is trains sitting and idling there all day, which, you know, our new neighbors, our new residents that will come and live at Reading Village won't like very much.
Okay. So start making a list of people we should talk to, whether it's people from transportation or at the state or even our own legislatures, right? What else would we do there? We could do a charrette. We could have a charrette if you want to have a workshop, and engage some of the people that have helped before. Bigger planners.
Should we set up a working group that includes like one or two of you guys and me and Andrew and some other interested? We'll just sort of make sure that this continues to take next steps and doesn't just fall by the wayside.
This, as you say, the Reading 2020 vision is a perfect place to start. I mean, basically hold it up and say, anybody interested?
Yeah.
There were tons of people who for the first time really came out when we did seems like now almost 2 years ago, these neighborhood design sessions, tons of people came out.
Yeah.
There was incredible interest. People gave really thoughtful and out-of-the-box ideas that, you know, we have lists of those, of who showed up and
oh, yeah.
some of those ideas. And so this there would be a lot of interest, I think, in the community for doing something like this.
Sure.
That was used as much as to get consensus around concepts. I thought the most interesting thing is those discussions were seeded with certain kinds of images to try to draw a response out of those present and try to force the discussion. I thought it was just so useful because you could show a complete vignette of the entire neighborhood and develop an opinion pretty quickly. It also helps you get neighborhood consensus. You know, one of the things we haven't talked about is everyone's going to have a different idea of what it should be and what it should look like. And this is a good way to try to develop, if not outright agreement, at least consensus of what it could be in a non-contentious setting.
Okay. Anything else? Closing?
It sounds to me like if we, you know, advance planning on this, plus the hopefully the developing design guidelines for the expanded downtown growth district and regulations for the stormwater process. That's a lot of work.
Yep.
Right. I mean that.
That's a full plate.
That's a full plate.
Basically, what we're saying is, we're really not thinking about zoning for November. We're thinking about more of this kind of stuff, and the housekeeping that we need to do.
And maybe there is some through this process and through input on maybe there are some smaller zoning issues that come up that we could act on, you know, relatively quickly. I think we should keep. I would think we should keep some bandwidth open for that to the degree that we can. Because we'd like, you know, it would be good to be able to respond, you know, in sort of a quick way. If
sure.
if we're getting feedback, right, with our new resource here, mm-hmm. getting feedback of something in zoning that's just putting, come on, everyone's looking and saying, walking away.
Yeah.
And we feel like they're giving us legit feedback, not developer, you know.
I'll continue to provide, you know, a private sector perspective.
Yeah.
Take it for what it's worth. But with the shared goal, I'll give you what I'm hearing out there.
Actually, I have a question for John. You didn't finish the story. Was there a happy outcome in Newport, Rhode Island?
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, down in Newport, they... well, they did not relocate their DPW. They have a plan and an approach on how they're gonna get there. But they did, you know, when we finished our plan, one of the things that we threw out there that we thought was a wild and crazy thing was a water park. And because it was right, for Newport that works.
Right,
and
sure.
Because there's not. There's not kid stuff to do in Newport as much, and that's what we were hearing. I finished the plan, put it out there, and really this is the power of doing those sorts of plans. Not more than 3 months later, we get a call from the economic development guy down there saying, he just got a call from a water park, and they explored it all. They ended up building a hotel and a water park on that site, but the, you know, it got things going, and that's really the one of the benefits of doing something like that. Because if you push across the table, if you have on the table, this is what we want, then developers are like, well, we can do that. You know, they have an idea. It's not them coming up and saying, oh, well, will they go for this or will they not go for this? You know, if that's, you know, if we're presenting the plan and saying this is what they want, they'll either say, yeah, that's something we can do or we can't make that work or, you know, what have you. But at least they don't, they're walking in with some surety of not getting resistance from us, to decrease the, all of their costs.
That's good for tonight on that. Water park, write that down.
I'm surprised they didn't put hotels with the water park, like they have in like the upper Midwest.
Well, no, that's what we had suggested, a hotel and water park.
Oh.
And that's who came in, one of those developers, like in the Midwest. They couldn't make the water park piece work, and they just did the hotel. But they came in with that whole concept.
It got them in, yes.
What's the one, there's one out in like Fitchburg, what's that?
Great Wolf Lodge.
What, yeah.
Yeah.
Great Wolf Lodge, yeah, that was it.
Okay, let's get the working group stuff started.
Okay, I'll send an email tomorrow around.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. I like it back, better back here. It's a lot easier back here.
So minutes.
Minutes, I sent you my comments, they're only.
Yes.
If I didn't have anything else on those.
Okay. So minutes for January 9th. I don't know if you all still have them from last time.
Mm-hmm.
Did you bring yours?
No.
I think I have an extra.
Let's get lost in my office.
Well, you want to look at them.
Karen, I have an extra one.
I just used it.
All right, thank you.
I'll take it.
Oh. Nick had a question about on page 5. The paragraph actually starts with Chairman Halsey. Chairman Halsey asked about the area being considered. Mr. Sexton commented that mention of the lots not being deep enough came up at the July forum. And to clarify, that was a comment that was made about the lots along Main Street being too long and shallow. Do you want me to change the way I worded that?
It just didn't make sense. That mention of the lots not being deep enough came up.
That it was mentioned,
yeah,
that the lots were not deep enough. Okay.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And then, Nick had me reword the last sentence of the last paragraph on page 5, which actually ends on page 6, by just saying enforceable design standards instead of the roundabout way that I worded it.
Right. Commission teeth. Nick, did you catch this? I'm not sure I know what it means.
It's your comment. I did see it because I looked up in stating to make sure it was actually not correct word to use there.
Okay.
Which word?
Instating a moratorium seems like the obvious first step.
Okay. Are we ready?
Comments for the ninth? Okay.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of January 9th, 2017, as amended.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Abstaining?
And then the ones from January 23rd, I just was working on finalizing today, and I did everything except for adding the list of documents you reviewed, which I figured I could just do after you vote on it. Not a big deal.
I looked through these. I don't have any comments on these. That's the extension for 36.
Have comments on it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So any comments on the January 3rd, 23rd?
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of January 23rd, 2017, as presented.
Second. All in favor?
And the minutes from 2:13 are not ready yet.
Okay. Any other updates? Other than the CITGO sign?
Mutual Oil that rebranded to CITGO. I don't remember actually approving those signs. I remember we approved the pump.
The pump. We talked a lot about the pumps.
And I talked a lot with like their sign designer, but I don't remember actually approving them.
This
so.
Is South Street, right?
Right.
I just didn't get a chance to look into it today, but.
Yeah, I was a little surprised to see the quick like a bunny changeover. I mean, it was a wham bam, you know, done in 4 days or something like that. Mm.
They had a DEP deadline they had to meet.
Okay.
They were pushing up against that, I know, so that might be.
Okay. Well, if there's nothing else.
Julie did a ton of work and submitted to the state for a 1-year certification.
Safe Harbor.
This is that because of the Reading Village 40B.
Mm-hmm.
Generating more than the 0.5% increase of the base of what our unit count is for subsidized housing inventory. So we submitted all the documentation to request a 1-year hold on all future 40Bs because of that project generating all those units at the same time. We get to count all the units on Reading Village because it's a 40B. So if there's any good side to that project, is that it put us in a position to ask for a 1-year hold from the state on future 40Bs. Now, that won't affect the St. Agnes.
Okay.
They were already filed. And maybe if St. Agnes happens in 2017, then we get another 20 units. And we're pretty close to meeting a 1%, which would give us 2 years off. And the next project in the queue, hopefully, that'll make up that difference is the post office with 11 units. 11, right?
Yep.
How quickly would you expect to hear back?
Well,
from the state.
Whether it's a word in any sense.
It should be cut and dry.
Should we be following up with our legislative caucus to help you?
So far, they've been really responsive. I just reached out to them last Thursday. They called me on Friday. I submitted it today.
They seem to be very responsive, but they should always let us know if that's, you know.
They might come back and say, well, we want to wait at least until the appeal period's over on Reading Village.
Couple more weeks.
I wouldn't be surprised. I mean.
Yeah, that's not a big deal.
Usually you do wait until after the appeal period's over before you do anything, so. But they may be saying, well, by the time the state gets around to, you know, doing what they need to do on approvals.
That period is passed.
That period might, the timing might be right.
Well, we just want to be sure that we're in a good spot around that. I mean, the wheels move slowly in government everywhere, but painfully so there. I mean, we still don't have a sign by law. You guys did that in November.
That's not true.
Yeah, but that, the AG's office tends to take that 90 days that they're allowed. This is kind of the people like us at the state in the Housing and Community Development Office that this should be pretty routine.
Yeah.
It's real, we're not creating anything new. We're going by their rules and submitting the documentation so that we think we can qualify.
Well, the last thing is tangled into another one, as Barry pointed out earlier, another one of these 12 to 18 month wrangles that are, you know, I mean, it's not productive.
Such a drain on resources for, you know, for so long.
When does that go into effect? So if they respond to you tomorrow?
It would go into effect as of Thursday when the decision was filed with the town clerk.
Okay.
And if St. Agnes then hit, that gave you, because it's already in flight, right?
They're on file. Yeah, they're ready to roll.
And that's worth another 1%? And when does that start?
So we would go 68 units for Reading Village, 20 for St. Agnes. So now we're up to 88. And
we need 96.
96 is the magic number.
Right.
So it ends up being, you know, another 8 units that we need.
So
and
if the
right
post
now,
office goes, is that?
Post office is 11 units.
Now
so
that's kind of exciting.
To get you over the goalpost.
We're there for a 2-year reprieve. And even if we apply for the 1 year and then we kind of a few months later come along and say, okay, now we're ready to apply for the 2 years, the state has told us that, you know, oh yeah, you can do that.
And let you play catch up.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's really good news.
So we're immune for a couple of years.
That'd be a 2-year, yeah.
I also submitted the 40R application to the state, which is required before it gets voted on at town meeting. So, and I got an email back already that it was very long and I need to read. But
yeah.
Okay.
That one you need, like.
Yeah, it's very
clear deck.
So I just, yeah, exactly.
Okay.
That's it.
Yeah.
Great.
Move to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.